In today's session of Applied Mathematical Finance, I like to continue a little bit on the calibration. We already looked at the calibration of the LIBOR market model. So we started introducing a big model here, our model SDE for the forward rates. And calibration was actually the difficult part, finding here the coefficients of the diffusions, or if you think in terms of covariances, the diffusions and the correlation parameters. So we had a bigger section on calibration. The first part of this section, and maybe I like to recall one part of that, was what is the influence of such a parameter. For example, we can use sigma to calibrate two caplets, but surprisingly, we could also link the parameter sigma to swaptions, namely in a very nice way. That's here a slide from one of our previous sessions, and we could establish the link that there is almost a one-to-one relation between forward rate volatilities and swaption implied volatilities. So which forward rate volatility, if you think of the sigma I of t being a piecewise constant function, so discretized into small blocks of volatility, which of these blocks influences which swaption? And that was one part, so one of the first parts in our calibration session. And another nice part was then our theorem that we could derive an analytic formula to calculate the swap rate, the implied swaption volatility from forward rate volatilities, so from our model parameters. Okay, so that was just to recall two important parts from the previous sessions. And now we'll try to continue a little bit with some remarks. So now I will continue with some remarks on calibration. So first remark is that calibration is computationally very demanding. So of course we can do a brute force calibration, which means use a numerical optimizer, a root finder, a minimizer, and minimize the difference between the market data provided, so the prices from the market, and your model valuations, yeah, and try to find the best model parameters. So we could do brute force. And brute force is not so stupid, yeah, as it maybe look, yeah, because it has an advantage. Actually, there's a typo, should be brute force. So let's fix this. So this is not so brute force calibration is not such a bad idea. It looks as if this is just very straight, very simple, the first approach, and all other approaches are maybe better, but brute force has an advantage because it really calibrates the model that you are using. So I will later have another look at brute force when we just try to improve the computing power to solve this problem. But before I do this, of course, instead of increasing the computational power, we could also make the problem more tractable. One thing we have already seen is using analytic approximations. So we can make the problem more tractable by using analytic approximations that speed up the calibration. We have derived such a formula for special versions of our model, like the log normal model or the displaced model or the normal one. So that's an option. Another thing which relates back to this analyzing which parameter influences which financial product is bootstrapping. So bootstrapping allows me to reduce the dimension of the problem. Before we look at these, a few remarks, a warning. If we use a setup for the calibration, like, for example, an analytic formula, or say a somewhat simplified model, and then later use the parameters calibrated from this setup in, say, the true model, or in then using the Monte Carlo implementation of the model, product, then this may introduce a difference because the calibration parameters were obtained from a different method. Yeah? So for example, if we think of Black-Scholes or the Black model, yeah, if we think of the Black model for a caplet, we can determine the correct parameter sigma from inverting Black-Scholes formula. If we then use this parameter sigma and plug it in into an Euler scheme approximation of the model, and assume now the Euler scheme approximation is such that it has a numerical error, yeah, then it's not clear that this parameter will actually lead to the optimal distribution. Yeah, so there is a difference coming from the use of the parameters in your numerical implementation and the way you determined the parameter. So this is a calibration error. Yeah, so you calibrated the parameter and you have a calibration error when you later test your financial product. So we can compensate for this calibration error by just using the model that is later used for valuation for calibration. So assume that I would like to value a swaption, then instead of using the analytic formula, I could just calibrate the Monte Carlo swaption. Maybe I like to show you this in a little piece of code, yeah, and because this illustrates a little bit what I like to do, I have here a small, yeah, a little bit maybe larger test program, which performs a calibration of the LIBOR market model using a numerical optimizer, yeah, which we can have a look at later. So let me just step very quickly through this code, yeah, because it's more the results which I would like to discuss with you here. So I specify here a matrix of swaptions. Yeah, so you see there are option expiries and swap tenors specified here, so and it's a combination of 1 month and then different swap tenors, and then 3 months and different swap tenors, and here we have different values for the at the money normal volatilities of these financial products, and I would like to have my model calibrated to all those values, so lots of financial products. So I built here the products which I like to use in my calibration, and I would like to match the normal volatility. So that's just here a loop over all those values and create the corresponding financial products. Then I create the model I would like to calibrate. So I have a time discretization. So this goes to 40 years, semi-annually. Then I specify a certain volatility and correlation matrix, yeah, correlation model. And this one here is a piecewise constant volatility model. But the time discretization of the model is a bit coarser than what we saw above. Yeah. So this is 1 year, 2 year, 5 year, 10 year. Yeah. So it's not so fine. So I have fewer parameters than products I like to calibrate. So we can expect that the model will not do 100% fit. But already note that there are many parameters because this is also a matrix. So the matrix of sigmas for the forward rates. So I have here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Yeah. So 7 times 7. Yeah. So around 50. So actually half. Yeah. Because the matrix is a diagonal one. Because the model is shrinking. Yeah. So it's around some 20 parameters. Whatever. Okay. So it has quite a lot of parameters. So for the optimizer to find the optimal value, well, here in this test program, we can check the normal model or the displaced model. I just checked the normal one. Then we have to specify the optimizer that we use to find the optimal value. And I will use here the Levenberg-Marquardt algorithm, which we can discuss later. Yeah? So just think of this as a black box. So this is provided by some optimizer factory. So you can plug in different optimizers to be used here. And then we specify some properties like the spot measure should be used. It's a normal model. And that's it. Yes. Then create here the forward rate model. Okay. So this calibration code will just repeatedly value these financial products and try to find the optimal value of the parameters. The funny thing is that here, this code that performs the calibration, that performs the optimization, is very general. So it can be used with any financial product. And here is a small helper function that creates the calibration product. And this helper function has an argument, calibration product type. And this calibration product type can be Monte Carlo or it can be analytic. Okay, so by changing this parameter, so actually the parameter which we pass here, actually we will change between two different financial products. Maybe I have a look at this. Let's jump into this function here. So we can decide between two different financial products. One financial product is our analytic formula, which we have derived in one of the last sessions. Yeah. So the analytic formula, and this formula only uses the model parameters by performing a numerical integration, and it does not use a Monte Carlo simulation, or we can use just a normal Monte Carlo implementation of the swaption. So, maybe as a small side note, in order to have this work, the model implements something that is called lazy initialization. So lazy initialization means the Monte Carlo simulation is not created until somebody requests a forward rate value at a future point in time. So until somebody requests a value that requires the Monte Carlo simulation. So you can create this LIBOR market model or this forward rate model or all the Monte Carlo methods models. You can create them without actually generating the Monte Carlo simulation. And when a financial product is not requesting it, it will not create the random numbers, the forward rates, and perform the Eulers scheme. So it's just that plugging in different products already decides whether I'm fast or slow. Okay, so I have this small test program. Yeah. So I use these products here to calibrate the model. And then I have here this, oops, this is here. So I use here these products, yeah, sorry. So I use here these products to create here the model, and then I have a calibrated model. Okay, so then I do an additional step. I like to test my model, and I create another model, which is a benchmark model. And this benchmark model uses actually the same covariance structure. So it uses here the covariance matrix from the calibrated model, but it may use here, for example, a different number of passes. So I can benchmark my model with a different number of passes. Okay, so I would like to run this small program with Vue. And my first test case is that I would like to use the analytic formula, so the analytic financial product, to value the calibration product. So as a, so I would like here to use the analytic product as a calibration product and calibrate this model. Yeah, let's just run it. We use the normal model. Calibration product is our analytic formula. We use 1,000 passes during calibration, but this doesn't matter because we use an analytic formula. And then we use a model with 1,000 passes, a Monte Carlo simulation model, to benchmark it. And here's what we get. Yeah, so we get a calibration, and the calibration error is in expectation zero. So the optimizer found some good value, but the root mean square deviation is still there. Yeah, it's 0.006%. So there is still some deviation. Well, my model has fewer parameters than we calibrate financial products. This is expected. Yeah, so there is some residual calibration error just because we have fewer parameters. Okay, but then what happens if we look here at evaluating now with a Monte Carlo simulation, the same swaption? Then we suddenly see that there is a strong bias, yeah, and there is a larger, yeah, also due to this bias, root mean square error. Okay, so clearly the calibration looking at the analytic formula and the valuation using the Monte Carlo implementation create different values. So the calibrated parameters do not fit to the Monte Carlo valuation. Okay, so what can we do? We can, of course, use a Monte Carlo financial product to perform the calibration. So let's run the program again. And now I use here a Monte Carlo implementation of this calibration. So now this takes quite a long time. I believe it takes a minute or so, because now in every iteration, he is performing a full Monte Carlo simulation, valuing all those many products, and checking the difference to the target value. Okay, so here's the result. Yeah, so we were using now the same implementation in calibration as we use later in valuation, and of course we see the same errors. And he has performed something. He has removed the error from the numerical valuation by performing calibration. I will start another calculation here. And since this calculation takes a bit, let me increase here the number of passes from 1,000 to 50,000 passes. And while this calculation runs, let me go back to the slides. So what we just did is we compensated the numerical error by calibration. Yeah. So I have a numerical error in my valuation. So maybe the distribution is not 100% correct, created by the Euler scheme, or there's a Monte Carlo error. And he is adjusting the model parameter to match the given input value. So actually, this may be an advantage. Yeah. So you can reduce numerical errors by calibration. Think of, for example, the following example. There you have an Euler scheme of, say, some log normal process. So say we use sigma Li dW, and I use an Euler scheme. Li, say, in t is Li in zero plus sigma Li zero delta W. Okay. Then you know that the distribution is not log normal. Yeah. And it's not right. The distribution is not right. So if you start here in T zero, this is the little t, and you plot here the distribution, then you have here some normal distribution, yeah, where you know it should be log normal. And what the calibration will do is adjust maybe this parameter here to compensate for errors you see. Okay, the important thing is this may be an advantage. It may also be very dangerous. Because what's happening here is you adjust your model parameter to compensate for a numerical error, which is maybe good, but also it hides the numerical error. So compensating numerical errors may be dangerous. So while it was an advantage on the previous slide, it may be dangerous because it hides the numerical error. And in the previous calculation I did in my small test program, you saw that I had a very nice calibration, yeah, zero error on the expectation, 0.007% on the root mean square. So very nice result for the calibration. And I saw that all the products were fitted in pricing. Yeah. But is this now the true model? And is the model also pricing or valuing other financial products in an accurate way? So this question is still open. Yeah. So the model maybe looks accurate on the calibration products, but the model is maybe not accurate on other products. For example, it's not clear if we just remove the Monte Carlo error and the model has a huge Monte Carlo error. And for that, let's repeat the calculation with a higher number of passes. So I go back here and I use now the benchmark model with a much higher number of passes. And you see that actually the error which we saw between analytic formula and Monte Carlo valuation, it's of the order of magnitude of the Monte Carlo error, because if we now use a higher number of passes, yeah, then we see that the model calibrated with the low number of passes gives parameters such that if we use a high number of passes, there is a large error. So you see that what happened is the calibration really removed the Monte Carlo error into the parameter such that the model gives you a good value without the Monte Carlo error, because the Monte Carlo error is already in the parameter. So the next step would be to compare a model that uses an analytic calibration with a model that uses a high number of passes. So I place here analytic, and then in the number of passes used for benchmarking, I have now 50,000 passes. Okay, the model analytic model used 1,000 passes, but the passes actually don't enter into the calibration, so they don't matter. So the calibration is quite fast, yeah? So actually faster, and now he's using this big model to value the products. Yeah, and you see that, of course, there's still an error in the Monte Carlo valuation. So there's still a difference between the analytic formula and the true Monte Carlo valuation, but the difference is quite small. And the difference which we saw before was just the error because there were too few passes here. Okay, so this is something important to learn, yeah, that if you use brute force calibration, this is an advantage. You can remove numerical errors, but it also makes you blind to numerical errors, and you should check what is the true error. Of course, we also see that our analytic formula is not 100% correct. Yeah, there is still a deviation. Well, it could be that this here is the Monte Carlo error. One has to check. Okay, so here on the slides, just the remark that you should run this program. Yeah, so this program is here in our repository with the experiments, and you can play a little bit with these values and check what happens to the calibration and how does the calibration compare to a benchmark. Yeah, and here are just the values which we just produced. So to repeat here again, yeah. So this is the calibration here using the analytic formula. Yeah? But we see that using a Monte Carlo simulation, the values are off. But we use a Monte Carlo simulation here with only 1,000 passes. So now if we use exactly this Monte Carlo simulation, so let's mark this here in blue. I use the Monte Carlo simulation with 1,000 passes now to perform the calibration. Then calibration removes the error. So removes the error on the Monte Carlo product. Of course, if we then independently check this again, then we get the same result because it is just the same product. Having the same implementation, yeah, no analytic approximation. Okay, and what happened? The Monte Carlo error, which we saw here. So, and actually at this point, we didn't know that this is here the Monte Carlo error. So when we see this error here, there could be several sources. It could be that the analytic formula we used in calibration is wrong or is not accurate enough. Or it could be that our benchmark is not consistent, not accurate enough with the true solution. Okay, so at this point, it's actually not known where the issue is. Okay, so using the Monte Carlo implementation fixes the issue in the sense that we get consistent values, but we could calibrate to a numerically faulty value. And using now here much more passes, okay, we see that the Monte Carlo calibration actually created a model that is, well, you could say not stable, yeah, with respect to the number of passes. So likely, you know, so the conclusion is that there is a huge Monte Carlo error that has distorted the calibration process, yeah, and the Monte Carlo error has become part of the calibrated parameter. So Monte Carlo error. Yeah, so here the Monte Carlo error from using few passes has become part of the calibration parameter or calibrated parameter. Okay, so too few Monte Carlo path. Okay, so that was maybe a nice excursion, yeah, on calibration. Analytic approximation is an important tool to speed up the calibration, but also the analytic approximations, they are just approximations. So we need to check the approximation error. For example, by comparing with a Monte Carlo valuation like I did it here. Yeah, so this is now the nice comparison. I have an analytic calibration here and I have checked against a Monte Carlo implementation with a higher number of passes. Okay, actually we can combine the two steps, a brute force Monte Carlo calibration and an analytic one. You could do an analytic calibration to find a good value for the parameters, then use this as the starting point for the optimization using the Monte Carlo product, optimizing the parameter a little bit in this neighborhood, and improving the parameter and maybe also removing some numerical errors. So yeah, always have to be careful, check different Monte Carlo valuations, for example, with different Monte Carlo seeds or with different time discretizations to get a feeling of what is the numerical error. And then if you have this, you can compare it to the analytic solution or to the error of the analytic product. So if you like to have a look at a brute force Monte Carlo calibration, you may also use this unit test here, which performs a brute force calibration, but also the program which we just executed does this.